Hello students, welcome to the second lecture on ground improvement techniques. So before going to the second lecture, let's quickly revise the first session. Okay, in our first session we will learn about what is ground improvement techniques, what is the engineering properties that are going to improve using ground improvement techniques. The engineering properties are, we already discussed, those are permeability, compressibility and shear strength. So what are the basic terminology that we are going to use throughout our subject? Okay, this one is also completed. What is compaction? What is compaction? Compaction means immediate removal of air and water from the soil. It is known as compaction. What is consolidation? Consolidation means removal of water under constant loading. It is a long time process. Okay. So what is permeability? Permeability means it is a property of soil which allows the water to flow through it. Okay, it is the name of the property of soil. It changes from soil to soil. Whereas percolation is the name of the process. The flow of water in vertical direction in soil is known as percolation. What is seepage? Seepage means the horizontal flow of water in soil is known as seepage. Percolation and seepage are the name of the processes, whereas permeability is the name of the property. Permeability changes from soil to soil, but percolation and seepage are constant definitions. Okay. So coming to swelling and shrinkage. Swelling and shrinkage generally occurs in case of clays. Okay. Swelling means increase in volume. When we add some water to the clay absorbs the water and its volume gets increases. That is known as swelling. What is shrinkage? The decrease in volume of soil, which means the increase in volume of clay, is known as shrinkage. Shrinkage occurs when the water in clay loss due to evaporation or due to various factors. If the water in clayey soil is lost due to various reasons, then its volume gets decreases. So the property of decrease in volume of soil is known as shrinkage. Okay. So we explain it through examples. Soil is a three-phase system. When we apply the load, only water and air coming out immediately. That is known as compaction. Consolidation means it is a long time process. Okay, this we already completed. This is an example for permeability that we already discussed in our previous class. Okay, so this is also completed in our previous class. What are the applications? GIT, ground improvement techniques, has so many applications, that is in case of foundations. By using GIT, we can increase the load bearing capacity of soil. Load bearing capacity is applicable during foundations. And also earthen dams. Earthen dams are generally used as a reservoirs to store the water. So because of the water flow, the slope of the earthen dam may fail. So by using GIT, we are protecting the slope of earthen dams. Third one is pavement design. Pavement design means roadways. When we are constructing a roadway, for example, certain length of soil is not suitable for the construction of roadway. So by using ground improvement techniques, we are changing its properties. So make it as suitable for the road construction. The next one is presence of problematic soils in our site. Okay, problematic soil in the sense we already discussed. Acidic soil, alkali soil or clay or organic soil. Okay. If any of these soils present in our site, by using ground improvement techniques, we are going to modify their properties. Okay, so as to make them suitable for the construction work. Next, retaining walls. Retaining structures are generally used to retain the earth. Okay, here the retaining structure is a soil only. By using some ground improvement techniques, we are protecting the retaining structures from failures. Okay, the last one is underground structures. Okay. By using GIT, we can also improve the properties of deep layers of soil. Not only the surface soil. By using GIT, we can also improve the properties of deeper layers of soil. Okay. Coming to the objectives. So, by using GIT, we can control swelling and shrinkage. We can modify the permeability of soil. We can increase or decrease. That's why we use the term as modify. Okay. Next one, reduce compressibility. Compressibility means change in volume of soil under compressive loads. Okay. For example, if you apply any compressive loads, its volume gets changed. Okay. the property of change in volume of soil under compressive loads is known as compressibility. Okay, we can reduce the compressibility of soil. That is the objectives of ground improvement techniques. Next one, reduce chances of liquefaction. Liquefaction means it is a phenomena occurred in soil, that is the soil loses its shear strength and stiffness due to vibrations. Okay, the huge amount of vibrations that can generate in soil are due to earthquakes only. Okay, by using external forces we cannot generate that many vibration forces. Okay, earthquake can generate larger amount of vibration forces that causes the liquefaction. Okay, next one, increase in shear strength. We can increase the resistance to the shear stress, that is shear strength of soil using JIT. Next one, preventing erosion of soil. Erosion means removal of soil. By using JIT, we can also prevent the erosion of soil. Okay. So this is the 6 unit syllabus you have. The first one is in situ densification of soil. In situ means in the field itself. Okay, we are not taking the soil to the laboratory. We are improving the soil properties in the field itself. Okay, densification means making the soil particles closer to each other. Okay, initially the soil is in loose condition. The distance between particle to particle is very high. So densification means making the particles closer to each other. Okay, so we are going to use some methods to densify the soil in the field. Okay. What are those techniques and all we are going to learn in unit 1. Unit 2 is, we already discussed dewatering, removal of water. We need to lay foundations below the groundwater. Okay. We have a situation that we need to excavate 7 meters of soil in order to lay foundation. But the water table is available at 2 meters. So first of all we need to dewatering. We need to remove all the water in the site. Then only we can lay the foundation. So what are the various dewatering techniques that we are going to learn in unit 2. Unit 3, stabilization of soil. These are all chemical methods, adding some chemical properties of material to the soil. Okay, for example, cement is a chemical material, lime, fly ash, adding all these materials to the soil is the stabilization of soil. The next one is reinforced earth. We are providing some excess material that is known as reinforce. We are providing some excess materials to support the earth. So what are the various excessive materials that supports the earth? Like soil nails, bamboo sticks we can also provide, or precasted piles. These are all external materials that is useful to reinforce the earth. Okay? Geosynthetics. Geo means earth, synthetic means polymer. What are the some polymeric materials that we can use to modify the properties of soil? There are so many types of geosynthetics that we are going to learn in unit 5. Coming to the 6th unit, grouting. Grouting means the forceful application of material to the soil. For example, take mortar. We are applying a mortar with certain pressure to the soil in order to prevent the slopes. Grouting is generally useful for overhead structures. Okay, like slabs. In case of underground structures, we can protect the roof of the underground structure using grouting. Up to now, we have completed in our previous class. From today onwards, we are moving to the first unit. Okay, that is in situ densification methods. What are the in situ densification methods? There are two types. The first one is for granular soils. In situ densification of granular soil. The second one is in situ densification of cohesive soils. Okay, total in situ densification methods are two types. One is for granular soil, second is for cohesive soil. So what is this granular and cohesive? Okay, first let's discuss about cohesive. Cohesion means, for example, there is two soil particles. There is two soil particles. Initially, generally there is a attractive force between these two soil particles. Okay, there must be attractive force between two soil particles. Cohesion means the attractive force between two similar particles. Both the particles must be same, soil, soil, or water, water. Okay, the attractive force between two similar particles is known as cohesive soils. Okay, for example, One material is soil. The other material is water. Obviously, there is also an attractive force between soil and water. The attractive force between two different materials is known as adhesion. Okay, cohesion and adhesion. Adhesion means the attractive force between two different particles. Cohesion means attractive force between two similar particles. Okay. Actually, the soils are classified into two types based on cohesion. There are cohesive soils and cohesionless soils. What is the example for cohesive soils? Cohesive soils. Cohesive soils are clay or silt. Clay and silt are the cohesive soils, which means there is a high attractive force between two particles in case of clay and silt. That's why clay and silt are known as cohesive soils. Why? Because there is a so much of attractive force between two clay particles or between two silt particles. Granular soils are cohesionless soils. Granular soils is also known as cohesionless soils. Okay, cohesionless, which means there is no attractive force. The best example for cohesionless soils are sand and gravel. In case of sand and gravel, there is no attractive force between two particles. For example, take some of the sand in your hand. All the particles act as a separated particles. Okay, there is no attractive force. There is no binding between the sand or gravel. But if you take clay into our hand, it is somewhat like there is so much of binding force. You know, Vinayak Chaviti. Okay, all those are made with the clay soil only, not with the sandy soil or gravel soil. Okay, that is also one of the example. The plasticity of these two soils is very high. We can mold them into any shape. But the cohesive soils are non-plastic soils. We cannot mold them into any shape. Okay. So, in situ densification methods are two types. The first one is for granular soils. What are those methods? There is two methods available. The first one is vibration at ground surface and at depth. The next one is impact at ground surface and at depth. Here we are dealing with two methods. At ground surface, at depth. At ground, at depth. Okay. These are the in situ densification methods of granular soil. So in today's class, let's discuss with these two only. Okay. In our next class, we are going for in situ densification of cohesive soils. Okay. In situ densification of granular soils. So what are the various methods to densify the granular soils? So the methods are briefly divided into three types. The first one is vibroflotation. Vibroflotation is again divided into two types. Vibrocompaction, vibroreplacement. Okay. The second one is dynamic compaction. The third one is stone columns. These are the most popular methods to densify the granular soils. Okay. So let's check out one by one. You first of all observe the name closely. In the name itself, the entire process is depending upon. Okay. Just observe the name. Vibro, which means this method must and should contain some vibrative forces. Okay. We are going to apply some vibrative forces. That is for sure. The next one is flotation. Flotation means not in the sense of float in case of water. Flotation means float in air. Okay. We are going to float something in the air. And we are also imparting some vibration forces. Okay. In the name itself, it is very clear. Okay. So let's move on to the next one. Vibroflotation. Vibroflotation is a general ground improvement technique. By using this, we can compact up to a considerable depth. Okay. The depth is generally about 30 to 50 meters. So by using vibroc rotation, we can densify the soil up to 30 meters to 50 meters with effective, with so much of efficiency. Okay. See, this is the one of the diagram which indicates vibroc rotation. Okay. Here you need to observe three main parts. The first one is a probe which is hanging in the air. This is what is meant by flotation. We have the heading vibro flotation. Flotation means floating in the air. The probe is floating in the air. That's why the name of the method is known as vibro flotation. Okay. This equipment is known as probe. Okay. The first component is probe. This probe contains of, here you can see some water. Okay. The probe is connected with some kind of jet of water. You can see these pipes and all. These are providing the water to the probe. Okay. Let's have a closer look at it. The second component is boom. This component is known as boom. Okay. By using the boom, we can move the probe in case of horizontal direction. Okay. The first of all, we completed it here. Next of all, by using the boom, we can move it to the other location in case of in the horizontal direction. Okay. Boom is used to move the probe in horizontal direction. The third component is, see these wires. These are known as hoist ropes. H-O-I-S-T. Hoist rope. By using the hoist rope, we can move the probe in case of vertical direction. We can penetrate it into the soil or we can lift it out of the soil. Okay. These three are the major parts you need to observe. The first one is probe, contains of water jet at the bottom. The second one is boom. This component is known as boom. By using boom, we can move the probe in case of horizontal plane only. Okay, the third one is hoist ropes, used to move the probe in case of vertical direction. Okay, these three are the major parts you need to observe. So the next one, this is the closer view of probe. This is the probe. The probe contains two water jets. See, these two are the water jets. Okay. The jet of water. The water is applied very forcefully into the soil. This is the water. Okay. Here what is happening is, when the water forcefully applied onto the soil, it makes a quicksand condition. Which means the soil is not very hard state. It becomes a soft soil. Okay. With the self weight of the probe, it can easily penetrate to the soil. Okay. The mechanism is, first of all, we apply the water with some pressure. That creates a quicksand condition at the bottom of the probe. So by using the self weight of the probe, it can penetrate into the soil. So likewise only we can penetrate the probe into required depth. For example, we need to penetrate it up to 5 meters depth. Okay, this is the same mechanism. Okay. See, coming to the principle. Principle means working mechanism. How the probe is going to work. First of all, when the probe is penetrated to the required depth, by using a quicksand condition and jet of water, we can penetrate the probe into required depth. Okay. After penetrating, what is going to start is, it is going to create some horizontal vibrations. Okay. It is going to create some horizontal vibration at the required depth. The horizontal vibrations break the frictional force, frictional content. There is no cohesive force. Cohesive means attractive force. Frictional force means the force at the surfaces, the force between the two surfaces. Okay. The horizontal vibrations break the friction between the sandy soils. It is generally useful for sandy soils. Okay. When we increase the dynamic stress, first of all, we apply a dynamic stress of 0.5 grams. It breaks the soil structure. The soil structure is break down under dynamic stress of 0.5 grams. further if you increase it more than 0.5 grams, so what is happening? If you increase it more than, that is 1 to 1.5, if you increase the dynamic stress to 1 to 1.5 grams, that creates a fluidized soil, nothing but quicksand condition. The soil is not in a solid state. When we increase the dynamic stress to 1 to 1.5 grams, that make the soil fluidized. Fluidized means semi-liquid state. Okay. Further, if we increase it to 3 grams, it will lead to dilation. Dilation means complete liquid. You can easily penetrate. Okay. So, this is the principle. First of all, it creates horizontal vibrations which are breaking the frictional force and making the particles to settle. The second one is, when we create the dynamic stress of 0.5 grams, the soil structure is going to break down. When we further increase it to 1 to 1.5 grams, the fluid become fluid, the soil becomes fluid. Okay, that means semi-liquid. Further, if we increase it to 3 grams, the soil becomes dilation of soil. It becomes dilation. Okay, this is the mechanical principle or working mechanism of vibro flotation technique. There is actually two methods, right? The first one is vibro compaction, vibro replacement. See, vibro compaction. In this method, we are imparting some vibration forces to compact the soil. That's it. Whereas in case of second method, vibro replacement. Replacement means we are going to replace the soil. Okay? Let's see the first one. Vibro compaction. Vibro compaction is generally used only for granular soil. That too only for sandy soil. Okay. In the first sentence, you can see this method is allows granular soils to be compacted. Only the granular soils. That too only sandy soils. This method is only used to compact sandy soils. Okay. The second one is vibro replacement. This is generally useful when the soil available in our site is not too good. It has the properties, it has inadequate properties. Okay, you have to remember this word, inadequate properties. In such cases, we replace the soil using vibro replacement technique. Okay, so let's see the first one, vibro compaction. So this is a short video. Watch it. This is a method of vibro compaction. See, this is a sandy soil. By using a probe, boom and hoist ropes, we can penetrate the soil. We penetrate the probe to required depth and create some horizontal forces. The horizontal forces prevent the friction of the soil. Okay, they break down the frictional forces between the soil and the soil gets settled. See, observe here. How the ground surface is going to fall down. When we impart some higher vibration forces, the soil settles down. See, like this. Like this, we need to continue the process as length as we required. Okay, this is the mechanism of vibro compaction, the first method. Just penetrate the probe to required depth and create some vibrative forces, horizontal vibrations. That allow the soil to settle. Okay. So like this, again the soil gets settled. Okay. This is vibro compaction. After that, we use the rollers to compact the surface only. Coming to the next one, vibro replacement. This is somewhat different from vibro compaction. We are not just compacting. See the first one. See the first one. By using jet of water, we create a quicksand condition here that allows the probe to penetrate. The first step is penetration. See, in vibro replacement, the first stage is penetration. We need to penetrate the probe to required depth. That is generally using jet of water. Okay. The second step is After we penetrate the probe to a required depth, we impart some horizontal vibrations. Okay, that is vibration, second step. The third step is backfilling. So what we are doing here is, after we penetrate it to required depth, by using a crane or something, we are laying some soil in here, in both the directions. Okay, because of the space between the probe and the ground surface. In the space between probe and the ground surface, the soil particles we are going to lay gets down. Okay, after it gets down, we lift the probe to certain depth. Again, we lift the probe. Likewise, we completely fill the soil with a new material. Okay, we are replacing all the soil in this location and we are placing some new soil. Okay, this is what is vibro replacement is. So just watch a short video so that you can easily observe. See what is happening here. We penetrate the probe to required depth. Because of the gap between, it is not good here. Because of the space between probe and the ground, the soil is settles to the bottom. Okay. Again we dig the probe to new soil. That soil is also gets cut the probe to certain height. Again backfilling. Again it compact the new soil. Again lifting up. Okay. Likewise we create a like a column like structure. This is what is vibro replacement method. We are replacing the soil in this location and we are placing some new soil. Okay. Coming to the advantages. The first advantage is, by using this, we can compact the soil without disturbing the surrounding structures. Okay. For example, there is so many surrounding structures. By using this technique, we cannot disturb any surrounding structures. We can complete our work without disturbing the surrounding structures. That is the first advantage. The second one is, it is eco-friendly. By using this technique, we are not harming the environment. The third one is, it is the fastest and easiest method to compact the soil. Okay, these are the main advantages using vibro compaction. Okay, coming to the applications. Advantages and applications both are different. Applications means what are the various situations that we can apply vibro flotation. The first one is, if the soil contains less than 15% fines. Okay, generally if percentage fines are more than 15%, it is very difficult to compact granular soils. But this technique is useful even if the granular soil contains less than 50% fines. Okay, if it contains more than 15% fines, this method is not applicable. Okay, if we have to use the vibro flotation method, then the granular soil must contain less than 50% fines. Okay, that is the first one. Second one, if the foundation pressure up to 1 MPa, megapascal, can be safely carried. So by using this, what we can achieve, a maximum of 1 MPa foundation pressure, that is bearing capacity. We can hardly achieve 1 MPa bearing capacity only. If we require more than 1 MPa, this method is not suitable. The third one is offshore compaction of seabed. Okay, there is nothing but beaches. For example, we need to construct some structure at the offshore seabed. In such cases, we can use vibro flotation method. The third one is liquefaction mitigation. Okay, we are already applying the vibrative forces. So even if the earthquake occur and the vibrations can again create, it does not cause any liquefaction because we are already imparting the vibration forces. The second one is sinkhole remediation. Sinkholes generally occur when this is the soil surface. Up to this depth, the soil is good. Okay. But there is a undesirable soil at the deeper layers of soil. Okay. At certain depth, the soil is, say for example, organic. the surface soil is very good, but at certain depth there is a presence of organic soil. So what happens when we construct a structure? The organic soil gets settled, which creates a sinkhole condition. Okay, so in order to compact the deeper layers of soils, we can also use vibroflotation method. That is the main. Sinkhole remediation means compaction of deeper layers of soil. Okay, the last one is densification of embankment zones and excavation bases to reduce permeability. We are dealing with the granular soils. So granular soils contains high permeability. So in order to reduce the permeability of embankment zones and excavation bases, we can use vibro flotation method. Okay, so this is the first method, vibro flotation. Okay, so let's summarize today's class. So what we learned today? First of all, we revise the previous class. So what we learn in our previous class is quickly revised. Okay, we revised the previous class. Then what are the in situ densification methods for granular soils? What is granular soils and what is cohesive soils? That we discussed. Okay, the next one is we learn about vibro flotation. What is vibro flotation? It has two methods again, A and B. Vibro compaction. In vibro compaction, we are not adding any new soil. Only by imparting horizontal vibrations, the soil gets settled. Okay, due to the breaking of frictional forces. But in second one, vibro replacement, we are replacing the soil by using some new soil. Okay, we are replacing the existing soil with the new soil in case of vibro replacement. Okay, well then what are the advantages and applications? Briefly, this is what we have discussed in our today's class. What are the advantages and applications? Okay, this is the summary of today's class. Revise the previous class, that is what is meant by GIT, what are the various terminologies that we are going to use, what is the applications of GIT, what are the various objectives of GIT, that we revised in comes under first point. In second one, what is the granular soil, what is the cohesive soils. So what is the example for granular soil? Sand and gravel, these two are known as granular soil, because these two soils are of zero cohesive forces. Sand and gravel are having zero cohesive forces. Granular soils is also known as cohesionless soils. Okay, sand and gravel are cohesionless soils. Cohesive soils are clay and silt. I should come into the first technique. Okay, vibro flotation. By floating a probe, we are creating some vibration forces. That's why it is known as vibro flotation. It is again divided into two methods. The first one is vibro compaction. We are not adding any material. We are just penetrating the probe to required depth and creating the horizontal vibrations. Okay, due to the horizontal vibrations, the frictional force between the particles gets breakdown. So as a result, the soil gets settled. Whereas in case of vibro replacement, we are replacing the soil with some new soil. Okay. Then what are the advantages and what are the applications? In what cases we can apply vibro flotation method? Okay. This is for today's class. In our next class, we are going to learn about dynamic compaction, second method of in situ densification. Thank you.